And people are also going to church, many of them. And we are always eager for more and more opportunities to fill our time with Krishna Katha. We only have a set number of weekends, days, hours in this lifetime, and the Srimad Bhagavatam specifically recommends that we try to utilize all those as much as possible in the process of direct devotional service. The most recommended of all the direct processes of bhakti are shravanam kirtanam, hearing and chanting. So today we'll have some kirtan. And we see that Advait, expert madunga player, is tuning the drum because the air is a little dry. It means it probably won't rain today. And after our kirtan, we'll have a discussion about the Srimad Bhagavatam, which will include some practical points that hopefully we can utilize in our lives to feel a sense of connectedness with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and which will help to also alleviate any of the anxiety that comes from our interaction with the material world. Do those sound like a couple of good objectives? Fair enough? Okay, four people think so. And be prepared, more and more people will come in, and so we'll just make space available as they come. It looks like we're pretty well situated here, but if you want to move up, if you see a space, you can do some defragmentation before they get here, all the better.
How's that drum looking right now?
Okay, Advait's saying it's like about a 5 on a scale of 1 to 10. Let's try it out.
That high end is not so good. Play that high end.
See, much better. Nama Om. And for those of you who are joining us for the first time, either here in the live studio or online, this next segment will be a practice we call kirtan, which is a call and response. The song we're singing, it's actually a mantra, it's sacred. It's comprised of names of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The mantra itself that we'll be concentrating on is called the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, and it has three words. Hare, everyone can say.
Hare.
And this is the word hara in vocative form, which means in a prayerful form. So we're calling out to hara, who's the feminine aspect of the Supreme, who's all accommodating and who helps those who are sincere about devotional life to come closer to Krishna. It also means one who removes one's obstacles. So if that sounds good to you, then feel free to really put your heart into singing to Hare, or also known as Srimati Radharani. Then we have Krishna. So this has two syllables, as you can see, and na is from the word ananda, which means bliss. The source of all bliss is our relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Krish means attractor, one who attracts us like no other. In fact, all the attractive forces that we see in the material world, that through which we spontaneously, or because of which we spontaneously turn our heads and pull our attention in a certain way, come from the original attractor named Krishna. It's an appropriate name for God. It means that he's all attractive. And then Rama is given a very clear definition in the Vedic Shastras. Ramate yoga no anante satyanande chidatmani. Iti rama pade nasu, panam brahma padiyate. This means that rama means the highest pleasure, and that the yogis who have given up the material world do so on behalf, because of rama, because they're able to take shelter of the pleasure potency that comes from rama. What to speak of spiritual strength that comes from rama. This is the most coveted of all assets that a human being can have, and this is spiritual strength. And by spiritual strength, as we discussed in class last week, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Vishaya vinivartante nirahara siddhihina rasavarjam rasopyasya param jishva nivartate. And that is that we may restrain our senses for one reason or another. However, as we do so, the taste for the sense object will remain. And it will remain so. In other words, we'll remain in a restrained position until we experience a higher taste, and that is we find something better than the object that we're looking at. And when we do so, it's our nature that will drop the lower for the higher. And this is extremely natural and spontaneous. The only question then is where to find that. And that is found in rama. When we find a higher pleasure that comes from the spiritual realm, we are empowered to give up the inferior or even profane energies of the lower material energy that's separated by consciousness from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That's a great relief. In fact, it's described in the Bhagavad Gita. It's Krishna says, when one enters into this mood and has the facility to give up the lower taste, he says, Brahma bhuta prasanatma na shochati na kankshati samak sarveshu bhuteshu madbhaktim labhate param. When one is able to come to the spiritual experience of connecting with Brahman, which is a pleasure that's above the pleasure we get from interacting with our senses and their objects in the material world, then we get a natural a sense of happiness, prasanatma. We become joyful, and we don't need any excuse for it, or no, there's no apparent reason for it. It's just a spontaneous, joyous experience. And this is one of the first breakthroughs that one will have when one's able to focus one's attention on the mantra. And also, one will be able to give up a hankering and lamentation, which are two features that the mind treats us to at every moment. Hankering for something that we'll never get, and lamenting for things that we didn't get, which is a strange position to be in. And finally, we'll develop a relationship with all living entities in which we see them as spiritual equals, in the sense that we'll see that everyone comes from the original same divine source, and therefore we'll have a sense of universal brotherhood with all living entities. All this comes from the chanting of Hare Krishna. It's a very well-considered science and enumerated and explicated in all the teachings given by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his disciples, what to speak of other Vedic literatures like the Srimad Bhagavatam. So having said that, it sounds like we should try chanting, doesn't it? Okay. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Shri Mate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine. Second line together. Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavani Paschatya Deshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Sari Gaura Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Kopremanande Nitai Gaur Haribo 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 Nitai Gaur Haribo. Even after we chant, you can feel the vibration. So we're very porous, actually. We have a lot of holes physically. And psychologically, what to speak of spiritually, which is the most subtle, the most subtle aspect of our existence, we're susceptible to our environment. And if nothing else, Krishna consciousness is science of which kind of environments we allow ourselves into and what kind of vibrations we take in. That affects us more than we might know. In fact, we're at all times taking in vibrations from the environment, whether we know it or know not. But bhakti yogis are very deliberate about taking in spiritual vibrations and also organizing their environments so that they can more regularly take in spiritual sound vibration. This, according to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his students, who explained the science of bhakti yoga in very practical ways, is the essential part of Krishna consciousness. And we subject ourselves oftentimes to vibrations that don't do us any good. In fact, they may cause us consternation, anxiety. However, a daily dose of straightforward, pure Krishna conscious vibration can cure all ills and can help rebalance us from the inside out. So this is the recommendation given by the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, coming down from our founder, Acharya, who recommends and has taught practical ways in which one can, first of all, chant Hare Krishna on one's own. No one can stop you. We've seen circumstances in which people have gone to great lengths to continue chanting Hare Krishna, even though people ask them to not chant Hare Krishna. For instance, in some countries, it's illegal to practice certain kinds of religious practices like Krishna consciousness, but devotees would find a place to go on chanting. We're pretty lucky in America so far that no one's actually really legally asking us to stop. I saw in Japan, although it's not illegal, of course, it's a very free society there. However, socially, it's not acceptable to be demonstrative in public. People generally in Japan who do a lot of commuting, this is a long way to go to keep that whole industrious society running. They'll sit on trains for hours and things. There's one devotee there who sits on the train and wears a mask, which is very common in Japan because they're aware of not spreading germs. If someone catches a cold, they wear a mask. So you see, at any given time, about the eighth of the population is wearing some kind of mask. And then she puts in some earplugs so she can hear herself chanting. And as she's going on the train, even though it's crowded, no one knows she's chanting. But she goes on. So one has to be inventive. One may live in a household where part of the household doesn't agree that chanting is a good idea. They should be maybe doing something more productive, like sitting around with the family telling jokes or watching television. and working yourself into a frenzy. But in all such cases, devotees figure out a way to go on chanting Hare Krishna. One such case we find in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in one of the great exemplars of bhakti, was Prahlad Maharaj. And although he was a pure devotee and had the great advantage that from the beginning of his life, actually before he was born, having instruction from Narada Muni. Narada Muni had known that Prahlad Maharaj was going to take birth and that he was a great soul. And he intervened with the plan of the devas, who thought that because this was going to be the son of Hiranyakashipu, that how much more disastrous that would be for the universe. Another one of the Hiranyakashipu clan taking birth. So they had kidnapped the wife of Hiranyakashipu and were planning on waiting till she gave birth and then end it all there with the little demon child, so that he wouldn't grow up and cause the same kind of problems for the universe that Hiranyakashipu had caused. It's a long history. It's all mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. But the long and short of it is, Narada Muni intervened, and he told the devas, headed by Indra, that actually is a pure devotee that's in the womb of the wife of Hiranyakashipu, Kayadhu, and that let me handle it from here. Prabhupada mentions in that section of the Srimad Bhagavatam that the demigods, the devas, they immediately agreed. And Prabhupada said, this is parampara. They didn't know, they were guessing, but Narada knew. And he told them what the situation was. And because it was coming from an authority, a spiritual authority, they accepted. So Narada Muni took this wife of Hiranyakashipu, about to be mother, to his ashram, and he took care of her. And he also went on giving her instruction. Actually, he was aiming the instruction at the embryo, who was Prahlad. And this is a very interesting point, scientifically, that even while he was in the womb, Prahlad Maharaj was able to hear and then understand the instructions of Narada Muni. At one point, a devotee many years ago was in a coma in the hospital, and the devotees came to chant for the devotee, and the doctor said, oh, she can't hear you. And they chanted anyway, and then she woke up, said, I heard you chanting. As I mentioned earlier, the soul is very subtle, and the vibrations that we take in around us have a profound effect on us. The most profound of all effects is that which comes from the spiritual sound vibration. And Narada Muni, with great intention, wanting to change the course of the universe, gave this instruction to Prahlad Maharaj in the womb. And when he was born, he was naturally educated about Krishna consciousness, so much so that when he went to his school in later years, when he was around 5 years old, he was fully ready to teach the science of Krishna consciousness, much to the chagrin of his teachers and his father, who were trying to run a school where kids learned about politics, how to negotiate between friends and enemies, how to dominate the world, and so forth. And Prahlad Maharaj thought in an opposite way. He saw all living entities equally. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, a self-realized person sees the soul within and notices that the body's there, but understands that body is only a temporary manifestation that the soul is dealing with right now and is not of great consequence. So this seventh canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam is full of practical teachings that we can take advantage of in the story of Hiranyakashipu. And as I promised earlier, I'm going to bring out a few practical points from the pastime of Hiranyakashipu, Prahlad Maharaj, Lord Narsingadev, in the next few minutes, and then we can discuss. And hopefully, my goal is that upon hearing some of these pointed lessons, you'll be able to take them home with you and apply them in your daily lives. Okay? Fair enough? Okay, 7 people said yes.
Yes.
Okay. 92% said yes. First of all, in chapter 3, the Srimad Bhagavatam, now that we have 99.9% consent to move forward, in chapter 3, I noticed that this chapter is called Hiranyakashipu's Plan to Become Immortal. Now, just observing the title of this chapter, we can learn a lot, because all of us know what happened to Hiranyakashipu. We knew how hard he worked to execute his plan. And we also know that we ourselves make plans. And we put a lot of faith in our plans, or at least a lot of hope that we'll be able to execute them properly and get the fruit that we're after. And it always works out the way we want. About 100% of the time. Whatever I decide I'm going to do, whatever plan I make, it comes to bear, right? No. In fact, Prahlad Maharaj, in his teachings to his schoolmates who are being indoctrinated in the science of politics, tells them that no matter what you plan in this world, you're going to get the opposite result anyway. Does that inform you about the nature of the world? This is not something people typically hear much about, but we hear about it in the Bhagavatam. And in this story particularly, Hiranyakashipu understood that there were laws in the universe, and he set out with more determination than anyone had ever done before to manipulate those laws and to enact his plan. In essence, what would you say his plan was? To become immortal. And the details of his plan, he thought it out carefully, because his brother was Hiranyaka. His brother had been killed by? Varaha was a boar. He was a transcendental pig and with lotus hooves. And he smashed Hiranyaka. He killed him. So one of the ideas that Hiranyakashipu had was that he would get a benediction from Brahma that he wouldn't be killed by any animal. Because he figured, you know, my brother was killed by an animal, so I don't want to be killed by an animal. So that was definitely on his list. That's well thought out, well considered. And he thought about many other aspects of the world and how one might die. He covered the time that he might die and triangulated to say not at day and not at night, and got that agreement taken care of. And he went down a long list. It's just to say that he had a plan to become immortal, and he really had to piece it together. And it didn't work at all. So Prahlad Maharaj says in his prayers in the 9th chapter of the 7th canto, when he's praying to Lord Nrisingadev, and this takes place after Hiranyakashipu was slaughtered by Nrisingadev. I mean, he was ripped to pieces. Very interesting, though, when he was torn apart by Nrisingadev, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who appeared in that form to impress upon the world how much he cares for his devotees, was thinking when he ripped the heart out of Hiranyakashipu. Sorry, I know it's a Sunday class. Kids, cover your ears. No, not really. Unless Prahlad was 5, so it was okay. It's mentioned that he took the lotus heart from the chest of Hiranyakashipu. And there our acharyas explain that the reason it was considered to be a sacred place is because Lord Nrisingadev had resided there. He's in the heart of every living entity. Krishna's there within our heart. Really, every body is a moving temple. And those who are spiritually advanced, what to speak of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, see every living entity as a moving temple because they see the divine spark within. What's more, they see that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is personally present there. He's so friendly to the living entity. There's a kinship since a time immemorial and that will always exist between the Lord and the living entity. And the Lord never forsakes the living entity. It's such a touching scenario, and it's there apparent to spiritually awake people within the body of every living being within the universe. What to speak of the Lord himself when he bifurcated the chest of Hiranyakashipu, and with his own lotus hands, he took his heart and he thought, how did so many impurities come into this heart? And this is one of the questions that the Lord always has. Even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he asked the son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, who had become a criticizer, so much so that he criticized Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and later on had fallen sick. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to rescue him. And upon rescuing him, he said, how have you allowed your heart to fill up with bitterness, with criticism for devotees? How have you allowed these impurities to come in? There's a question that Krishna can ask every conditioned soul. Sometime or another, I open the gate and I let them in. So when he tore open, did Hiranyakashipu, the chest, when Nrisingadev tore open the chest of Hiranyakashipu, he thought about that. How it was possible for Hiranyakashipu to have become overcome by these material desires. And then Prahlad Maharaj had offered his prayers to Nrisingadev, and in them he noted the fact that no one tried harder to execute his plan then Hiranyakashipu, my father, he said. And I saw what he had achieved materially. And then he said, I saw what he lost within a moment. He said, Hiranyakashipu had become so powerful that when he moved his eyebrows, the devas would cower before him. He had so much power. But then Prahlad said, within a moment, he lost it all. He said, therefore, why should I try to execute any plan in this world, to try to find some power, materially speaking, or to try to attain some opulence? Hiranyakashipu had the greatest opulence, supposedly. He had so many material assets at his command. In fact, everybody was working for him, and nobody could tell him no. Absolute power, practically, except for Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Everybody was subordinate to Hiranyakashipu. Of course, Narada is mentioned there too, but Narada Muni always stays close to the action. Even with Kamsa, he's like, yeah, I'm your friend. Let me tell you what's going to happen. As he knows how the how the internal energy works. So, and similarly with Hiranyakashipu, he stayed close. He pretended to be a subordinate. Meanwhile, he was watching the Leela of the Lord unfold. And so this chapter, just the title of it, is telling Hiranyakashipu's plan to become immortal. So that's a sutra that we can remember and live from. It takes a lot of pressure off because our plans to become semi-immortal or just to try to do better than somebody else, materially speaking. There may be various levels of aspiration in the material world, but if you take it from Hiranyakashipu or from Prahlad Maharaj, who saw the whole thing from the beginning, we can know for certain that whatever plans we make will not work out here in the material world. So we don't have to be attached to them. We don't have to invest so much into the plans for becoming well situated here in the material world. So, in chapter 4, we find Hiranyakashipu terrorizing the universe. That's the name of the chapter. Hiranyakashipu terrorizes the universe. And this is after he received benedictions from Brahma. He performed severe austerities, he got benedictions, and then he went about perpetrating crimes against all the Brahmins, the cows, the trees. He ruined the wells. He just wanted to disrupt human society as much as possible, out of envy. So Hiranyakashipu had received benedictions, and the first two lessons that we can take are, number one, don't make material plans, but do make spiritual plans. Because although we may not be successful materially, whatever plans we make, if we plan spiritually, we will be successful. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Neha bikramanashosti pratyavayo navidyate svalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. In fact, if you make even the slightest intention towards improving your spiritual life, coming closer to Krishna, Krishna notices it right away, and he'll help you become successful. Even the slightest intention. In fact, the example is given in the commentary of this section of the Bhagavatam. Prabhupada mentions Ajamil. Ajamil had become extremely entangled in the material world. It's hard to imagine someone becoming more entangled and find a more embarrassing situation than he was in, falling down from his exalted position as a brahmana and becoming wrapped up in degraded material activities. But just because there was a wisp of spiritual vibration in his life, what was that? He named his son Narayana. And just by saying that, all the acharyas agree on this, that he repeated the name of his son, Narayana, Narayana. In fact, Prabhupada stopped a lecture because he saw in the translation it was mentioned that he said it three times. Prabhupada said, you can hear this lecture. He changed it. He made the change. He said, why it says three times? He said, one time is sufficient. He said, Narayana, one time. That was sufficient. Atapite deva padambuja dvaya prashada leshanu grihita evahi. The Bhagavatam says, Brahma quotes this or recites this verse in the 14th chapter of the 10th canto, where he says, if you surrender just a little bit to the Lord, you perform just a little service, which means in Sanskrit, lesha, means just a slight fragrance of desire to serve the Lord, then you can please him. And Prahlad Maharaj, in his prayers, he was wondering how to appease Lord Nrsingadev. And there he says, Bhaktya tu tosha bhagavan gajayutapaya. He remembered Gajendra, who was praying to the Supreme Personality of Godhead before he even remembered who he was. But he had some sincere desire and a great need. Because the intensity of his prayer, Krishna was pleased. So this is the impetus of the Lord to hear from his devotee just one word of sincere prayer, one sincere intention within the heart that let me know who you are, and Krishna will respond. So if we make plans to advance spiritually, even if now we think that that's impossible, how will I ever do this? Krishna will reciprocate and he'll help us. And Prabhupada mentions in his commentaries in the 8th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, he says, I just read this morning, he said, I came to America and I started this movement with 40 rupees. He said, now I have 40 crores of rupees. And in only 10 years, how is this possible? He says, because I had a spiritual plan. I wanted to follow the plan of my spiritual master and of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Because I signed on to that plan, and look what happened. And he claimed again and again, it's not me. it's only my connection to my spiritual master and to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu through my intention to execute their plan. So this is the secret to success. If one subordinates one's own plans, it doesn't mean that you can't plan your life, because we have another aspect to our life. You may need to get a PhD in pediatrics and do research. You may need to become an engineer, learn how to code, or whatever it may be. But we don't put much stake in that. Only as much as the Lord endorses those programs, and only as much as our previous activities, whatever we're due in this life, will come to pass on that level. So we do that methodically, but dispassionately. However, for our spiritual planning, we can lose sleep. That's also what's called spiritual anxiety. For instance, here at ISV, we're always making plans that get us into trouble. From the very beginning, we've done that. And in fact, that's the energy that's actually kept us alive and together spiritually over so many years. It's been decades now. And we practically don't even notice that time's going by. I keep looking down and noticing that, like the other day, someone near Kula told me that Jayananda, my old friend Jayananda, who helped us find this temple, by the way, his kids are grown up and in some other place. I was thinking there's still little kids somewhere. And I was thinking, well, what does that mean about me? I didn't even notice. I didn't even notice that my life passed me by and that we were engaged, because we were so busy with our plans. Our plans, every time another plan to expand the Sankirtan movement to the best of our ability. It's not a big, they're not huge plans, but for us, They're a stretch. It's more than we think we can do every single time. And every single time that we make the plan and we feel anxiety about it and we try for it and we chant harder, and Lord Chaitanya somehow or other sends resources, we didn't know where they were going to come from, but they came. Then it's what it made of us to try for that counts. The fact that we had something to reach for, a plan that we were working on. In fact, Prabhupada told this as one of the secrets to management, to Karandar Prabhu, he told him, always create a fresh challenge so everybody in the congregation will feel compelled to reach up and try to grab it. And we all know that together we have so many spiritual plans according to our desires to work together to do something wonderful, to please Lord Chaitanya, to please Srila Prabhupada, to please the Vaishnavas. So this spiritual plan making is a good idea. Make plans. Don't be afraid. Make plans to increase your own effectiveness at controlling your senses and at expanding your outreach so you can help other people. And in the process of doing that, Krishna will help you and you'll become purified. And as far as your other plans go, be methodical, do what you have to do, but be dispassionate. This is the advice, in fact, of Prahlad Maharaj in his prayers, 9th chapter of the 7th canto. Balasya neha sharanam pitarao nashingha nartasya chaganamudhanvati mahajato now. Taptasya tat pratividir yari hanjisheshas tavad bibo tanupritam. He says that be aware of the fact that no matter what you try for in this world, for instance, he says, if you try to take care of your children, you may or may not be successful. He says, if you try to save a drowning man on the ocean, you may or may not be successful. He says, if you go to the doctor and take medicine from the doctor, you may or may not be successful, and the medicine may or may not be potent. It's all dependent on the mercy of the Lord. It doesn't mean, Srila Prabhupada says, that you shouldn't try to take care of your children, or save a drowning man with a boat, or to take the medicine when it's required. But you should know that it's up to Krishna. If you ask the doctor, what'll he or she tell you? Doctor? Will the medicine work for sure? Can you guarantee it? He's not guaranteeing it. No guarantee. But Krishna does give a guarantee in the Bhagavad Gita that if you give your plan making to me, if you try to expand your devotional service, Shripram Bhavati Dharmatma, Shashvash Chantim Nagachati, Kontaya Pratijanihi Nami Bhakti Pranashati, he guarantees it. In fact, he tells Arjuna, because sometimes Krishna has to lie to protect his devotees. So he tells Arjuna, you declare it to the whole world that my devotee will always be successful if he tries to engage in my service. So that's what we should try for. And a second lesson that is worth repeating, as I've said it before, it's a section in this pastime. When Hiranyakashipu asks for a benediction from Lord Brahma and receives it, the implication at the beginning of the chapter when he's just received the benediction is, well, maybe that wasn't such a good idea. And Srila Prabhupada writes in his purport that one should not ask for benedictions that one cannot enjoy peacefully. And in a modern song recently from the 1980s, David Byrne wrote in one of his lyrics, it was a famous song, "Watch out, you might get what you're after." So many things I'm after, and it's like, watch out, you might get it. And if you get it, will you be able to handle it? Part of Sambandha Gyan or studying the Bhagavad Gita is to understand what we can handle. What is it that we can actually take in, that we can digest, that we can really use in a healthy way in this life? This is why those who are advanced spiritually are very careful about what they ask for and about what they keep in their lives, because they know, if I get this, will it help me or will it hinder me? Therefore, it says in the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita that the only ones who are peaceful in this world are those who have given up all selfish desire and have decided once and for all that my main thrust in life is to serve selflessly the Supreme Personality of Godhead. All others, even so-called transcendentalists who are endeavoring for self-realization, but who have an interest in liberation or in getting some spiritual power, they're not peaceful either or at all. So this is an important element in our lives to study. Is that what do I really want? And is it rational what I'm asking for? Will it really help me if I get it? So before I go into the next few lessons, we'll take a few reflections. Anything you heard so far that stuck in your mind? Srivas Pandya Prabhu.
Prabhuji, more of a question.
Yes.
So when Lord Narsingadev ripped open the heart of Hiranyakashipu, and then he pondered on the question that why so many impurities came into his heart, I want to know what the acharyas say. After all, he was subjected to that situation by the Lord himself. Or rather, you know, he was asked to fall down. Maybe it was his own choice, but is there any further thoughts on that conundrum which people might ask? That?
Well, as you mentioned, it was a pastime because Jai and Vijay, who are doorkeepers in Vaikuntha, had prevented the four Kumaras from entering. They became annoyed and they cursed Jai and Vijay. And of course, we understand this was the will of the Lord. And we also know, those who study the Bhagavatam carefully, that all movement in the lives of devotees, significant movement, takes place by cursing. No, it's true. Every significant episode in the Srimad Bhagavatam is preceded by a curse. And we also know that curses are not bad when they come from sages. they precipitate something. This is not exactly on the topic of the realization I had when we were reading the 5th, 6th, and 7th canto in Vrindavan recently. And that is that the last vestiges of my material desires, I may be very dedicated, very, very dedicated to the process of bhakti. Nonetheless, there may be some last vestige of desire to enjoy the material world. Where does it come from? It's a residual effect of my hanging around here for too long. And who knows how deep it goes, but my realization of anartas is, although I've heard various points made by various pundits, but my own realization is they're like icebergs. You only see the tip. But if you look deeply enough, you'll find that it goes to a bottomless ocean. Practically, they're unfathomably deep. And when Krishna arranges for someone to be cursed by a sage, which precipitates some dramatic activity, for instance, even we hear about the pastime of Mars Chichiketu. Hey. Mars Chichiketu became a self-realized soul. And then he was cursed. Again, cursed. And then in his next life? Vritrasura was one of the famous personalities of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Vritrasura, what a tumultuous scene in the Bhagavatam. Huge battles against the demigods. I mean, he had to crush devas. I mean, that's not a recommended activity for a devotee. Chichiketu was a devotee. And what's more, he had to, in order to exit the world and go back to Godhead, he had to have his head chopped off. That's always fun, right? You wake up in the morning, please let my head be chopped off today. His head was chopped off. It took a whole year by Indra using his thunderbolt. I mean, these are dramatic scenes. And if you go through the Bhagavatam and you find and you see what it takes for devotees, even those like Dhruva Maharaj who were spiritually successful, then again, he had prayed for a benediction before he saw the Lord. After he saw the Lord, he said, I don't want anything. The Lord said, no, you take it. And he ended up having to stay 36,000 more years in the material world and rule. He also, got caught up in that whole thing, killing yakshas. It's a long story, but it was tumultuous as well. So my realization, and that is that I have some last vestiges, even if I'm the most sincere and well-intentioned devotee. And in order to get out of the material world once and for all, it takes some kind of major event to happen. Heaven and earth have to move in a very dramatic way. And this is exhibited in the Bhagavatam. For these great souls even to lift off and leave the material once and for all, some huge thing has to happen for them to go back to Godhead. Bharat Maharaj, what a drama. The three lives he went through. How'd you like to wake up as a deer? And you're fully aware, it's like, hey, wait a minute, I'm from Burlingame. Well, you're a deer now, make the best of it. And how would you feel? I mean, we think of it as, it's just a pastime, but it happened. And if you think what it's like to be humiliated like that, that you slipped and you fell and you came back as a deer, an animal, and what it takes, and how determined he became in his next life as Bharat Maharaj. This is what it takes. I mean, what did he do as Bharat Maharaj? He didn't interact with anybody socially. Do you ever feel like doing that? I feel like that all the time. It's like, that's it. I'm just not talking anymore. not really, but I mean, deep inside, I see Bharat Maharaj as a great hero. And once and for all, and what did it take? And not half-hearted effort. Not 90% effort, 110% effort. So these anartas are not easy to overcome ultimately. In one sense they are, we depend on Krishna, but the last big blast has to come. from the mercy of the Lord. And that may look like something that's really dramatic. It will be dramatic. In order for me to finally sever my tie with the material world altogether and give it up. Parikshit Maharaj. I mean, we can go on and on and on. There's so many. Gajendra. So, I don't remember the details of what the Acharyas said in that section. We can look at it a little bit more. But they do note the fact that this is something that the Lord himself stops and notices as he's bifurcating Hiranyakashipu, fully conscious that he's his devotee, and he's thinking, like, how'd this all happen? So the Lord's energies work in amazing ways, even so that they amaze Krishna himself. Yes, Bali Mardan Prabhu. Microphone will be to you within 4 seconds or less, or your money back from this lecture. 3, 4. Gosh, that was close.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
I have a question related to, in Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, it says like, sadhu sanga, sarva shastra kai, lava matra sadhu sanga, sarva siddhi hai. So how can we say that Hiranyakashipu was associating with Narad Muni, associating with even Prahlad Maharaj, a great saintly person, and there are many demons in the history, they have the best of the best association. You can imagine of Kansa, he has association with even Vasudev and Narad Muni, and you can, Hiranyakashipu, Duryodhan even had interactions with Krishna, Vyasadev, and many other, Vidura, many other acharyas. But why there is no transformations of heart to those devotees, even though they have a sadhu sangha all the time? And how can we really see, but only two examples, exception is Jagai and Madhai, which is separate, they got transformation, but I don't see any ancient history, the greatest of the men, the greatest of association, but still there is no less, no change of heart. So could you explain why it is?
But there is, and this is brought out in the seventh canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, very demonstratively by Shukadev Goswami, that actually these demoniac people, for instance, there's Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaka, and then we have Kumbhakarna, Ravana, then we have Shishupal and Dantavakra. These are the three births of Jaya and Vijaya in the material world. And the question comes up from Parikshit Maharaj, how is it that Shishupal, how did he get the benediction of liberation? Everybody knows that from his birth, when he first started talking as a baby, the words that came out were blasphemy of Krishna. That was his baby talk. And throughout his life, he held a complete enmity for Krishna. Now, very interesting section here of the Bhagavatam, and a famous verse, in which Shukadev Goswami points out, in fact, that these demons are very fortunate. Narada Muni's pointing out, these demons are very fortunate, because they have such intense concentration on Krishna. And this is the answer to why they're transformed. Of course, Shishupal, in the last couple seconds before the Sudarshan Chakra from Krishna cut off his head, he thought, wow, Krishna really is kind of beautiful. I mean, the Sudarshan Chakra is fast, so you got to think fast before it chops your heads off. And he thought, wow, Krishna's really beautiful. And he attained liberation because he was thinking Krishna. Everybody except for Vena and people like Vena. In fact, it's so, the demons are extolled as being such fortunate people, in fact. The verses say that, oh, by the devotees, I wish I could be that fortunate to think of Krishna so intensely as all these demons did, Kamsa, Hiranyakashipu, and so forth. Said, I wish my devotion was as intense, I was as intense in thinking of Krishna as these demons are in thinking of him out of hatred. But we learn from the Srimad Bhagavatam, from other shastras, that kama, krodha, sahaja pranayadi bhiti. Yam kama krodha sahaja pranayadi bhiti vatsalya moha guru gaurava sevya bhavai. And there's a similar parallel verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, which I haven't memorized, but it says the same thing, and we all know this verse from the Brahma Samhita, that whether one approaches the Lord out of kama, lust, krodha, anger, kama krodha sahaja, natural friendly love, bhiti, out of fear, and so forth, one gets the same result, one's purified. So the transformation takes place if the demon is thinking of Krishna and recognizes his form, then that person becomes liberated by that. The only ones who don't are those like Vena, who disregard the form of the Lord altogether and say, there is no God, I'm God, and so forth. You were going to say? 7130 in the Srimad Bhagavatam. This verse proves it, since I just happen to have it right here. And we have a pundit in the third, fourth row. 7130 says, Kamad dveshad bhayat snehad yata bhakyeshvare mana avesha tad agham hitva bahavas tad gatim gata. That's a nice, got a nice rhythm to it, doesn't it? Bahavas tad gatim gata. Can you say that? Bahavas tad gatim gata. So bahava means many, tat of that, gatim, path of liberation, gata, attained. So this answers Bali Maharaj's, Bali Prabhu's question. So what happens to these people who are averse to Krishna? Well, if they concentrate on the form of the Lord, even out of hatred, they attain the supreme destination. Translation is, many, many persons have attained liberation simply by thinking of Krishna with great attention and giving up sinful activities. This great attention may be due to lusty desires, inimical feelings, fear, affection, or devotional service. I shall now explain how one receives Krishna's mercy simply by concentrating his mind upon him. So, what other reflections you have? Anantadev Prabhu. Microphone just now coming.
Just to build upon Bali Maharaj Prabhu's question, we understand on the deeper level that transformation takes place, but just to kind of keep it on the surface level, because I'm pretty much on the surface level myself, one thing is that, a reflection for me is, Narada Muni, all these great souls were giving their association, but there's also a part on our end where are we open to receiving that association? And so just tying that into, you know, we came out of Kartik and Damodar Leela, we understand that one thing is Krishna is bestowing his mercy, and the other side is that we have to also make the endeavor. So similarly in association, was Hiranyakashipu really open to aligning his plan with Krishna's plan? Or was he still, or not Krishna's plan, but aligning his plan with Narada Muni's plan or the other great souls? Or was he still adamant in moving around in the world based upon his own plan? So I think association doesn't just mean in physical proximity, but also the association within the heart, opening yourself up to allow yourself to be moved by the great souls. And I think that's the difference here that we see with those who are transformed, at least on the surface level, and those who may not be, the demons and such that we find in the Bhagavatam.
Yeah, thank you very much. That helps to move the answer along a little bit more. And it also is important to note that Hiranyakashipu also had to take birth again and again. And he got liberation in the final birth that he took, as I mentioned, when he came in contact with Krishna directly and was able to appreciate something about him. And so there's a special potency mentioned and a circumstance under which he becomes completely perfect or liberated, at least, by coming in contact with Krishna. Okay, so I'm going to look at my watch because there's no more clock on the wall, and I don't want you to think anything bad by me looking at my watch, but here I go. Okay. So, Prabhupada, in verse 12 of chapter 4 of this seventh canto, makes the point that no one in the three worlds can live in peace and prosperity without disturbance. I don't want to disturb your minds by this, but it actually helps to know this fact, and we call this adjusting expectations. I was once with the great Rupanuga Prabhu of Southern California, who teaches management at Chapman University, illustrious family and great devotee. I was talking in management terms, and I said about one has to lower one's expectations. He said, the term is manage your expectations. One has to manage. He said it very humbly because he's such a humble person, but I said, yeah, that's the perfect adjustment. So this section teaches us to manage our expectation and tells us that you'll never find peace or prosperity in the material world. Okay? I hope you found that helpful. Therefore, and this is important, therefore, in text number 20 of the fourth chapter, we find in the purport the secret to success. But we've run out of time, so thank you for coming. Okay? Oh, all right, here we go. The secret is there. Let's look into it. Text number 20. That's 7.4.20. And let's look at the verse. This verse in English says, Hiranyakashipu thus passed a long time being very much proud of his opulences and transgressing the laws and regulations mentioned in the authoritative Shastras. He was therefore subjected to a curse by the four Kumaras who were great Brahmanas. And if we scroll down into the purport, we're going to find the key to success. There it is. It's from the Bhagavad Gita, 16:23. Now you may ask, you know, how do I find out what is Krishna's wish? How do I organize my life in such a way that I will be successful, that my plans won't be thwarted by material nature? And the answer is given very clearly in the 16th chapter. After Krishna goes through a very short but extremely pinpointed definition of what it is to have a demoniac mentality. And it's uncanny how accurately he describes the demoniac mentality, which is very much exhibited today in today's world in many different ways, especially in philosophic ways and postmodernism and so forth. But here's the antidote. And this 16:23 says, Yashastra vidhim utsrija vartite kama karata nasa siddhim avapnoti nasukam na param gatim. First of all, it says, if you don't follow Shastra, there's three things you won't get. Would you like to know what you don't get when you don't follow Shastra? Okay, so the three things are siddhim, that means perfection or completion of whatever you want to complete here in this world, you won't get it. Clear on that? Okay. Second one is sukham, which means happiness. So you won't be happy if you don't follow Shastra. Understood? And the third is param gatim, which means the ultimate, the supreme destination. You don't get that either. So what three things don't you get by disregarding Shastra? Number one? Number two? Number three? So if anybody's willing to forego all those three, then feel free, help yourself, follow your own plan. So if you scroll down a little further, you'll find that there's a tasmach, which means therefore, and that's what I was coming to. This therefore, appears in the same chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, tasmach shastram pramanam te karya karya vyavastitau gyatva shastra vidhanoktam karma kartum iharhasi. So yavastitao means that one should be very focused on this. Just like we know from the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, vyavasayatmika bhutir. One's intelligence has to be focused in a particular way in order to be happy. Vyavasayatmika bhutir ekeha kurunandana bahusha kahyanantascha buddhayo vyavasayinam. He says that you should focus your mind one-pointedly on the process of devotional service. If you don't, have this intelligence that's fixed in the goal of life as being devotional service, then you'll have many other plans, bahushaka, unlimited types of plans. Especially nowadays, we can't get any peace. It's almost impossible to find any peace because of all the distractions. This was predicted in the Srimad Bhagavatam 5,000 years ago. Prayanal payusha shabhya kalavas minyugejana manda sumanda matayo manda pagya hupadrita. In the Iron Age of Kali, men have but short lives. They're quarrelsome, lazy, misguided, unlucky, and above all, always disturbed, which definitely describes the addiction to scrolling and looking at multiple images that come in and not even looking at them, just like, and it's practically impossible in this environment to focus one's mind. But the purpose of life is fulfilled if one can bring one's attention back to the Shastra and take good instruction coming from, for instance, Bhagavad Gita, and develop an attraction for that. So this is the secret to success. And this is the way that the great souls attain perfection also, is they find out what the essential teachings of the Shastra, which is infallible, are, and they follow that in their life without deviation. Or if they deviate, they pull back to it. They know how to pull back to it. Otherwise, Prabhupada gives this analogy, whatever kind of success you're trying to attain in this world, including overcoming the powerful forces of birth and death, is like catching hold of the tail of a dog to try to make it across the ocean. I mean, imagine if you were there and you saw a dog swimming around and you thought, let me grab onto its tail and he'll pull me across the Pacific Ocean. I'll end up in Okinawa, Japan. This would be foolish. And similarly, those who know the power of the material energy, the futility of trying to execute one's own plan, say that our endeavor to independently become successful in this world without the help of Shastra is like holding on to the tail of a dog, hoping that he'll pull me across the ocean. I'll just let that sink in for a minute. It's a nice image. Okay. So follow the Shastra for perfection, happiness, and supreme destination, but don't hold on to a dog's tail. He won't help you. Even if he's sincere, he won't help you. And what happened, I want to just bring out two more points. When all this turmoil came to the residents of this universe, when Hiranyakashipu got his power, well, ultimately the devas began to pray very intensely, and their prayers were answered. So let's look at text number 22 and 23 in the fourth chapter. And here we find that the devas, when they're overcome with the power of Hiranyakashipu, they're taken out of their own positions, they're prevented from performing sacrifice and so on. They start to pray and they say, let us offer our respectful obeisances unto that direction where the Supreme Personality of Godhead is situated, where those purified souls in the renounced order of life, the great saintly persons, go, and from which, having gone, they never return. Without sleep, fully controlling their minds and living only on their breath, the predominating deities of the various planets began worshiping Hrishikesh with this meditation. I really like this verse because it gives some indication of the kind of concentrated desire one must have to have effective prayers. Of course, all prayers are effective, but those that have intensity are particularly effective. And listen, without sleep, fully controlling their minds and living on only their breath. So if you chant japa like that, not recommending necessarily, but if you put your heart into it and you have the intensity of purpose, these demigods, even though they couldn't see the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they were just pointing their prayers in the direction they knew he was. Of course, he's in all directions. That comes out in the story of Prahlad Maharaj. But their intentionality was such that, like, just let's put the prayers out there. And they were effective. Because then we find in the next verse, then there appeared before them a transcendental sound vibration emanating from a personality not visible to material eyes. The voice was as grave as the sound of a cloud, and it was very encouraging, driving away all fear. So this is a result of intense prayers directed towards the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He'll help us. And finally, he tells them, O best of learned persons, do not fear. I wish you all good fortune to you. Become my devotees by hearing and chanting about me and offering prayers, for these are certainly meant to award benedictions to all living entities. I know all about the activities of Hiranyakashipu and shall surely stop them very soon. Now wait for the last line. Please wait patiently until that time. So, here Prabhupada takes the liberty in his translation of pointing out that hearing and chanting is a direct connection to the Lord. And the verse points out, and so does his purport, that one must be patient in the practice of devotional service. He knows when the right time is to show up. Have complete faith that he will show up. He's already showed up in the transcendental sound vibration. Study the science. Understand the spiritual science that Krishna is present in his name. He's also present in Srimad Bhagavatam. And in the association of devotees, and in the Ganga, and in Jagannath, Baladeva Subhadra, and in Krishna Prasadam. Study the science and understand that he's there, and continue to connect with him, and he'll show up at the right time, just as he did when he killed Hiranyakashipu. So the last two lessons, pray for help, and pray hard. And the last is, be patient, because help is on its way. Krishna never forsakes his devotees, even if they one time ask for his shelter. He'll take that seriously for eternity after that. This is mentioned in the Ramayana when Bibhishan asked for shelter of Lord Ramachandra. And Lord Ramachandra said, somebody asked me one time for shelter, that's it. I take care of him forever after that. Somebody sincerely asked me for this. What to speak of those who repeatedly ask and continually stay in a humble state of mind, taking shelter of the Lord. So in summary, the five lessons are, number one, make spiritual plans. Feel free to plan out your life for your increased sadhana and for expanding the Sankirtan movement. Plan to give your resources as much as possible to do this and your heart and soul, and you will be successful, guaranteed. We've seen it again and again and again and again that everyone's successful. On the other hand, just as a reminder, no matter how hard you try on the material side, your progress will be thwarted by material nature and your plans won't come to pass. I'm just saying. Number two, be aware of what you're after. Can you peacefully enjoy it? Analyze it. If I get what I'm asking for, is it really going to make me happy? Once I have it, will I be peaceful? Just take a mundane example. Think of the nicest kind of, maybe, I don't know, what's important, a vehicle? You get a vehicle, the nicer the vehicle you get, the more you're going to be worried about somebody scratching it. what to speak of stealing it. But it goes, it covers all the various benedictions that one might ask for in the material world can be epitomized in a car. When you go to buy a car, I got this advice many years ago, don't love the car because it won't love you back. If you fall in love with it, then you're an easy mark. The person will say, yeah, you need the undercoating, right? That's an extra $2,000 and destination charge, blah, 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 blah. Next thing you know, you got to work for the next 5 years to pay for the thing. And by the time you pay for it, it's a piece of junk and it also is outdated and you need the other one. Especially nowadays with technology, because technology moves so fast. No matter what you get, it's going to be outdated in a couple months. And you'll be in anxiety. You can't catch up. The material world is not a place where you can get something and keep it, and you can be happy with it. So be aware of what you're after. Can you peacefully enjoy it? Number three, follow the shastras for perfection. No, don't catch the dog's tail. Number four, pray for help. And how hard should you pray? Three people got that. How hard should you pray? Very, very hard. And number five, be patient. Yeah, no, study how the Lord works. Study how he thinks. Study what he says and have complete trust in that. Might as well, because he's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Other people can say whatever they want about what might happen, what might not, but Krishna knows. Vedaham samatitani vartamanani charjuna bhavishani chabutani mamtu vedana kashchana. Krishna says, I know everything. So trust the person who knows everything and can do something about it and who is our best friend. And be patient. Wait for him to do his part. He's already doing it, but he knows exactly when to make all his moves. So do your part and then let him do his part. And now we'll just take some last few reflections on the lessons that we might have taken from this.
Our heart is a sacred place. I liked that you explained that in the beginning because Krishna always resides there. Thank you, Guru Maharaj.
Yeah, heart's a sacred place. And in fact, it's mentioned in the Chaitanya Charitamrita in a very elaborate purport, which is a paraphrase of a talk which was given by Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. This is in the cleaning of the Gundincha Mandir, which is an analogy. And it actually took place, but it's analogous with cleaning our hearts. And we have to be meticulous in cleaning out all the dirty things from the heart, even the most subtle of them. And there it is said that when you've completely cleaned your heart, then you can install Krishna there on the throne. Beautiful Shringasana. Then you can hold a festival and invite all your friends. And it's like, yay! I'm free. Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu, for the nice class. You said about planning that makes spiritual plan not material. Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, spiritual plan means plan how to make your practice of Krishna consciousness better. There's a lot of ways you can do that. One way is to make sure that you build into your schedule a time every day to hear and chant, especially reading Prabhupada's books. You can read Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Nectar Devotion, Nectar of Instruction, Shish Upanishad. What else? Chaitanya Charitamrita. There's a lot to choose from. It won't, there's no dearth of Shastra. So you should plan how to read all these books. And that's a good plan. Do you have a plan how to read them all? If you don't, I suggest you try our app. It's available on the App Store for both iOS and for, what's that other thing called? Android. Oh yeah, Android. Android, and so you can go there and you can download the app, it's free, and both of them will give you facility to look at a goal and say, when will I finish the Srimad Bhagavatam? You should know that. You should have it written in your notebook somewhere and say, I will finish the Srimad Bhagavatam on this date. And you'll know that for sure when you go to that app because it will tell you how many pages or how many shlokas. There's a toggle switch for either if you're on electronic or you're on paper. you have to read each day in order to complete each one of the works within a given amount of time. Srivas Pandit Prabhu and I worked on this meticulously together and worked it all out. And so there you have it. That's one example. Also, plan for your japa. How will you increase the quality of your japa? And then, of course, what kind of service do you have? And how can you improve the service that you have, especially for the missionary branch of the Krishna consciousness movement? Because if you absorb yourself in the mission of spreading Krishna consciousness, it's the best way to show compassion to all living entities. For instance, our Mayapur Bihari Prabhu, he came up to me one morning. He said, I have a plan. He had light coming out of his eyes. He said, I have a plan. I said, what's your plan? He said, I want to put Bhagavad Gita's in all the motels, hotels in North America. I said, go for it. And he, Dilip Bhai and his team, have been focusing on that for several years now. And is that absorbing? Absolutely. It's a kind of meditation. So think, and don't hesitate to think big. If you want a plan, I mean, you know, Steve Jobs thought about developing a corporation, and he did okay as far as, you know, material corporations go. It's worth over $1 trillion. He started in a garage somewhere. And you can start there in a garage too. Prabhupada started with 40 rupees, and now he has a worldwide movement going on. Even before he left the world, 1977, it was already on every continent of the world. He had been around the world 14 times. How do you do that? By linking into Lord Chaitanya's plan. So plan for that, and if you have the propensity for thinking ambitiously, channel it into the mission. Because all the other things you do, I mean, fine if you have a startup, I said before, pursue it. If you have a career, pursue it, but do it methodically, but dispassionately. However, with spreading the Sankirtan movement, be passionate. Put your heart and soul into it. Lose sleep. And do whatever you have to do to become a great success story in spreading the Krishna consciousness movement. If you do that, you'll be recognized by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If you sacrifice your sleep, not all of it, you should get 6, 7 hours, 8, whatever you need every day to be healthy. I'm not advocating fanaticism. But what I am advocating is put your heart and soul where it counts in spreading Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's movement. And if you don't know what that is, study it and see what is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu doing. Apply your intelligence and find out where to make that investment. Okay? Okay, what else? A couple more? Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you so much for your class titled Hiranyakashipu's Plan to Become Immortal. Early in the class, right, you made a statement about, you know, don't make material plans, but make spiritual plans. And I was thinking how Hiranyakashipu is a perfect example of what not to do. Basically, as you mentioned, he wanted to become immortal. He didn't get that boon, right? And then he tried to get more other boons from Brahma. And he almost like, he got satisfied with what he wanted, but then once what he got what he wanted, right, he started misusing them, which points to your last part of the lecture, right, where you said, Bhagavad Gita said, if you don't follow the scriptural injunctions, then you won't get perfection, happiness. I forgot what was the last one, but so all the things that you're not supposed to do, like he did it and then he fell down. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, so last one from Shraddha.
This is from Shastrakrit Das Prabhu.
Shastrakrit, wow. If you can attract Shastrakrit to your assembly, then something good's happening. Call me, Shastra. I got a question for you, too. Shastrakrit Prabhu, you know, he's been spreading Krishna consciousness for many years. And one of the things he's excelled in, amongst many others, is distributing books in Arabic language. This morning I was just trying to do a demographic study of the Bay Area and find out where most of the Arabic speakers are. Do any of you know where they are? They're in Fremont? Let's get down there. How many Arabic books do we have? Malini? in the book room? Over 1,000? 500? We can get more, right? Whatever we have Arabic books between now and the end of the year, please distribute all of them. We can take them out now, but figure out where these Arabic-speaking people are. And just a personal request to everybody who's listening and who's can get to the book room. Please take some Arabic books with you. Malini will facilitate you taking them, and we'll order more after you take all the ones we have. And figure out where the Arabic-speaking people are. This is homework. And distribute these Arabic books before the end of the year. Is that okay?
Yes.
Five people said okay. If you agree with this, say Hare Krishna. Okay, Shastra Krit.
Amazing discussion as always. Question, is it inevitable that Krishna always puts all devotees into difficulty, either as an example for others or to purify a conditioned soul? Or for some devotees, Krishna doesn't need to test them so much.
And the material world's always difficult. Our situation's difficult here. But Bhaktivinoda Thakur said something profound, and that is the difficulty that I encounter in executing my service to you, my Lord, is my greatest happiness in life. And if you can transfer yourself into that a space, into that attitude, where you actually feel happy to be inconvenienced for the sake of expanding your service for Krishna, then you're in an unassailable condition of life. The material world can't touch you anymore, because what will it do to you? What kind of difficulty can there be for you? So on the other side, as I mentioned, it takes some kind of dramatic act by Krishna to pull us out of the last vestiges of the material world. So it's kind of like the doctor, you know, he or she will say, you know, this is going to hurt a little bit. But you trust, you know, this is the best doctor, has the best, my best interest in mind. So you don't mind so much because you know you have to do it, right? So yes, there will be some difficulty, and there is difficulty, but it's administered by Krishna in such a way that it's with pinpoint accuracy meant to divest us of the last attachments to the material world that actually cause us perpetual pain and misery. Perpetual pain and misery. PPM is destroyed by Krishna and his campaign to rescue us from the material world. So just cooperate. It's not going to hurt for very long. Just for a couple seconds, and then it'll be okay. Hare Krishna. And one more thing.
Thank you. This is from Madhav Govinda Prabhu.
Madhav Govinda, Kijai.
Thank you for the nice class. I like the point about being patient and having trust in Lord's plan. He will help at the right time in separation from ISP devotees.
We're in deep separation from Madhav Govinda. Everyone who would like to add on to the petition to the lotus feet of Sri Sri Radha Madan Mohan and Srimad Mahaprabhu, Sri Lakshmi Nisringadev and Srila Prabhupada to please bring Madhava Govinda back to ISV. We should make t-shirts. And who agrees that in our humble request to their lordships that they please act expediently to bring him back as soon as possible. If you agree to this, please say Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna!
There you have it. Hare Krishna. Well, there we have it. We have, what do we have, 7 minutes? Goodness gracious. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama. Rama Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Rama Rama Hare Hare.
Thank you everyone for coming to ISKCON of Silicon Valley, and for those of you who joined us online from various places around the world, we definitely felt your presence. Very much appreciate that you took time to tune in. Now we're going to continue our program with dancing. Dancing is a integral part of the Bhakti Yoga system, and if you don't believe me, just haul off and start dancing and see what happens. So we're going to move everything out of the way, all the rugs, chairs. And if you're not dancing, just stand a little closer to the altar to give a little space for those who would like to dance and try it out. You can put your hands in the air like this. Try it. It lets all the anartas out of the heart. And if you jump up and down a little bit, they'll go flying out, like car keys, change, everything, it'll go. Okay, thank you very much, and we'll see you on the day.